I'm Bernie Cohen. I'm a retired professor of computing. in the business since 1965, so older than most of you. My son is here, he's Adam Cohen Rose, and my grandson is here, so we're three generations that has come from, so that's not very useful, so it's appropriate to be doing history. Afterwards, you might like to look at a few little exhibits I have on the desk here, just to illustrate some of the things from the past. This is going to be about the history of computation, not just about computing, and it's mainly about the people rather than about the things, and it's mainly about parts of history that you won't actually have, or you might not have heard of before, little wrinkles, little side corners of history, not all of which are recorded round the corner in the museum, which I hope you're all going to go to later. So, first of all, this is a very good year for doing this, and a very good place for doing this. It's Turing's birthday later in the month. It's his year. Computing at schools is all over the place, and so it's a very good time to be talking about the history of computing, and a very good place for it too. I'm very pleased to be here. I live in Guildford, by the way, and there's a house about a mile as a crow flies from where I live, with a blue plaque on the wall that says Alan Turing's mother lived here. And he'd stayed with her for a while as well. Okay, the other great person I'm going to be quoting a lot during the day is Oscar Dijkstra. How many people have heard of Dijkstra? Hey, very good. A really nasty man. Really vicious, horrible man he was. He said some wonderful things, and the DWDs are worth reading. So he said, for example, computer science is no more about computers than astronomy is about telescopes, which is not a lot of people understand. And also, simplicity and elegance are unpopular, because they require hard work and discipline to achieve, and education to be appreciated. So at a conference like this, where everybody's talking about mobile apps and all geeks and stuff like that, these comments don't go down very well. Okay. But I happen to believe them, so they are. I'm just old-fashioned. So we'll have a few more Dijkstra quotes. By the way, he was always keen to be called Edsger W. Dijkstra. He insisted on having the W, which is very odd, because he went off to work in Texas towards the end of his career, where he was called Eddie Baby, and that didn't work out too well. Right, now, the first person I really want to mention in the history of computation is a chap who lived from about 470 to 544 AD, and you won't have heard of him. He was Dennis the Humble, or Dennis the Little, St. Dionysius Exiguus. He was the man who introduced the number zero into Europe. Right? Of course, zero was actually introduced by Indian mathematicians, really. But he was a Scythian friar from Scythia, which is somewhere in the Balkans, nobody knows what Scythia is. And he introduced the number zero into European notation, which, if you've ever tried to do arithmetic with Roman numerals, you will appreciate how important that was. Okay, especially if you think about having a computer system that operated with Roman arithmetic. This would not be particularly easy. So he's very important to us. And, this, by the way, is a painting of him done sometime in medieval period, so it's obviously not him. But he also introduced the notions of BC and AD into the calendar. He was the first person to do that. Also noting that there is no year zero, by the way. He did not introduce a year zero, which is rather interesting. It was from 1 BC to 1 AD. And he also was the man whose formula for calculating the date of Easter was the one that was eventually adopted by Pope Paul I. And there's a very important thing about Easter. Has anybody ever tried to write an Easter calculation algorithm? It's not easy. There's loads of them on the web. Very, very messy. But Easter is actually terribly important as a problem, and I'll come to it later if you like. It actually connects biblical period with the Irish Troubles in a very sophisticated way. We'll get back to that later. Right, now, computers. Going back, when did we first think about computers? Computers were people originally, people who computed. Okay, they did calculations. And the calculations they did became important after John Napier, the Scottish mathematician, invented logarithms and his bones. The bones were the first calculating device. And the logarithms were the first thing that actually made computations
Sorry,
effective.
Can you say that again? Bones were?
John Napier's bones. Oh. Not his bones.
No,
not his bones.
Not his bones.
Right. But they were called Napier's bones. And they look like this, these things. And they sort of slide around. And they help you to do computations. It's a calculating machine.
Right, okay.
Mechanical calculating machine. They're called Napier's bones. And that was the first calculating machine. Blaise Pascal, the famous mathematician, French mathematician, he actually built a machine, the Pascaline, the calculator. And he built it in the 17th century. Not a lot of people realise that calculators were built. Actually, there's a much older calculator than that was fished out of the sea near Greece recently, which actually is a beautiful thing that's recently been reconstructed. That, what's it called? Antikythera
machine. An Android.
That's right. You can buy an Antikythera simulator now, that's right.
Mega version as well.
That is one. The Antikythera thing is absolutely a beautiful thing. And it was for calculating positions of the planets and predicting eclipses and stuff like that. Well, that's an analog machine. This, if you like, is digital. Pascaline. Later, we have later versions of this, including this thing here, which is a Brunsviga, my own personal Brunsviga calculator. You're welcome to come try this later. I challenge you to do a multiplication using this. Let's say to multiply 876 by 459. Let's see how many rotations of the wheel it takes you to do it. It should be much less than you think. It's a challenge on it. I did a postgrad diploma in Glasgow in numerical analysis back in about 1965, and we actually had to, under examination conditions, extract the roots of a 7th-degree polynomial using the Newton-Arsons algorithm, using one of them in the examination room. Such a noisy exam. Okay. The tables that were calculated using these things and the logarithms were extremely important in the 18th century because they were used for navigation. It's all very well having a sextant and a clock. Everybody knows about the navigation thing and the importance of the clock and the chronometer and so on, but without the tables, these were useful. You had to have the tables too. The log tables, your astronomical ephemeris, and all the rest of it. And these tables were calculated by people. And the people made mistakes. And the tables that were actually published had errors in them, and they caused ships to go aground. It was a serious problem, you know. And that's why Babbage, in his discussions with Herschel, around about the middle of the early 19th century, said, I wish to God these calculations had been executed by steam. And Herschel said, why don't you do something about it? So he did. And he developed the difference engine. Okay? Difference engine is a special purpose calculator. You see it around the corner. I advise you to go there. Actually, it is. It's in the Science Museum. They haven't got one here yet, I don't think. No, there's one in the Science Museum. We're going to put one in the museum here. I haven't got there yet. What that does is it tabulates logarithms and trigonometric functions by evaluating finite differences to create approximating polynomials. So in other words, it knows the main values of the logarithms and the sine tables, and it calculates the intervening values using finite difference techniques, which is lots of multiplications and divisions and additions and subtractions, which is what these people would have done if by hand, only that does it mechanically. And it actually prints them out. Very nicely done. That got built. The analytical engine, of course, didn't. But it didn't get built by Babbage. That was the next one. That was going to be the programmable version of the difference engine. The difference engine is not programmable, it just does the same thing every time I had it. Babbage pointed out himself in 1864, he said, as soon as an analytical engine exists, it will necessarily guide the future course of science. Okay, this is said in 1864. Whenever any result is sought by its aid, the question will then arise, by what course of calculation can these results be arrived at by the machine in the shortest time? This is algorithmic complexity in 1864. Right? Way ahead of his time, Babbage. So, of course, was Ada. Candace Lovelace. This, she programmed the analytical engine before it had been constructed. Right? She worked with Babbage on it, and she actually wrote programs for it, and it didn't exist. Right? Menabrea built one in Italy, and her programs actually ran on Menabrea's machine. But she actually wrote the code before the machine existed. That's some of her code. Right? That's a program for the analytical engine. I won't bother telling you what it does, I don't know myself, but anyway, that's what it looks like. If you want to write code in any other engine, that's what you do. It's hardly Java. okay, we'll jump way ahead now. We'll come here to Bletchley, breaking the code. That's the bomb that you see around the corner, was used to break the code of Enigma. This is Colossus, which is used to break the code of Lorentz. You see them both here. You'll be going on the tours and stuff. The theory of computation, however, that underlay all this construction started really with a guy called David Hilbert. Anybody heard of Hilbert? Mathematicians in the audience? Jolly good. David Hilbert, that German mathematician at Erlangen, had a number of postgraduate students all worried about the 10 problems that he set out. The 10 problems of mathematics, which he said, once these are solved, the whole of science will then be mathematized. We won't actually have to do physics anymore. We'll describe the universe in terms of mathematics. We'll be able to analyze and solve all the mathematical problems using the algebraic techniques that these problems represent, and then our work will be finished. And actually, at the same time as he was presenting the 10 problems, Russell and Gödel were both at work contemporaneously, pointing out,
there's a problem here.
And sorry about that, but I'm afraid we will never get there. However, one of the problems was called the Entscheidungsproblem, and a young man called Alan Turing decided to work on that, about computability, essentially, and he wrote a paper in 1936 called On Computable Numbers Application to the Entscheidungsproblem. And you can see that in the Proceedings of London Mathematical Society. And of course, he went on to construct the Turing machine, completely abstract machine, which is what we use to demonstrate what is and what is not computable by any machine, never mind what kind of machine it is. And also to demonstrate, using Turing machine, the Hawking problem, which is to show that, which shows that not every program is provably correct, or you can't even prove that every program holds. It's as simple as that. You know, does this program have an infinite loop in it? I'm telling you, in general. And of course, also founded artificial intelligence by asking his classic question. Meanwhile, his two contemporaries, both graduates of Hilbert, one's a chap from John von Neumann, we're working also on computability, theory of computation. Alonzo Church developed lambda calculus and showed how recursion could be made effective. We can't actually do any of our functional programming or any of stuff like that without his work. But he was also able to generate exactly the same results as Turing did about computability and about complexity, using his notation rather than Turing machine, so they're exactly equivalent. And a guy called Post did exactly the same thing, using a different technology. Von Neumann, of course, he invented stored program architecture. Without him, we wouldn't have any computers at all. But he also worked on self-replicating automata, which is kind of fun. And he also, of course, developed game theory, which is essential for modern economics. Dijkstra pointed out, von Neumann speculated about computers and the human brain in analogies sufficiently wild to be worthy of a medieval thinker. Right? Turing thought about criteria to settle the question of whether machines can think, which we now know is about as relevant to the question of whether, as the question of whether submarines can swim. Right? So Dijkstra's saying, these guys, yes, they were brilliant, but they were speculating about things which we now consider not to be terribly important at all. They were considered to be absolutely critical at one time. And now The hard AI question, can you build machines that actually behave like people, it's not really important anymore. And the question about computers and brains, are they equivalent? That's not actually terribly important anymore either. They're far more important things to worry about. But these were very serious issues at the time. Thanks for pointing out that we have far more important things to worry about. The man who actually built Colossus was Tommy Flowers. That's him in his later years. You'll see lots of pictures of him around this building as a young man. I actually worked with Tommy briefly towards the end of his life. It's been a big privilege, but it was a real problem. We were building dual processor message switches in the 60s and getting two computers to talk to each other in real time and stuff like that. Trying to design the hardware, and Tommy came and looked over our shoulder and said, I wouldn't do it that way. And we said, well, how should we do it, Tommy? He said, I can't tell you, but I wouldn't do it that way. And we didn't know what he'd done. Nobody knew what he'd done because he was completely silenced by an Official Secrets Act until way after his death. That's a waste of a great resource. Tommy's great contribution, not only in terms of the hardware design of Colossus, was that nobody believed that you could actually build a machine with 10 to 20,000 valves that would actually work, because the valves would blow up and burn out. Tommy knew from his work at Dollis Hill, as a post office engineer, one of the leading experts on tubes in Britain, that valves only burn out if you switch them off and on. If you leave valves on, they run for ages, for years. Well, that was the point about Colossus. They didn't switch it off. They left it running. And that's why they were able to build several versions, several Colossus machines, and they all kept running until the last one at GCHQ was switched off. Didn't go there. There's some more British pioneers in the history of computing that people aren't terribly aware of. Bill Shockley, Bell Labs, the invention of the transistor, Shockley and Bardeen, right? Nobel Prize. Bill Shockley was actually born in London. He was a horrible man, another ghastly man. Nobody could work with him. But he was the man who brought silicon to Silicon Valley. If it wasn't for him, we wouldn't have any of our integrated circuits or electronics or anything like that. The junction transistor was all his work. And everybody hated him for it because he was bull-headed. He was got to be like this. But he was actually born in London. He was American, but he was born in London. Freddie Williams, inventor of the Williams tube, you'll see him referred to around here. He didn't work here, he worked in Manchester. The Williams tube was the first electronic storage device. It was a CRT, a cathode ray tube, that you could read. Right? We think of cathode ray tubes as things that you write to. The Williams tube was, it left dots on the screen, and because the phosphor on the screen let the dot decayed slowly, you could actually read it back. So you could write to a screen and you could read through the screen. And that was the first storage device, first electronic storage device. Freddie Williams and Tom Kilburn built that, and it was used in the Franti Mark 1, which was in 1951 the world's first commercially available electronic computer. Don't let the Americans kid you. ENIAC and all that stuff, EDVAC, right? Yes, they were built in academic centers in the United States, but the first computer that anybody could actually go out and buy was the Franti Mark 1, 1951. Okay? British, don't forget. Based on the Manchester Baby, which was built by Turing and his friends in Manchester after Colossus. The world's first business computer was Leo 1, Lyons Electronic Office. This is Joe Lyons of Lyons Corner Shop. Okay. Can imagine this guy running a chain of coffee shops, and he says, in 1951, he says, I think we ought to have a computer to run our business. Okay. It must be crackers. But they ordered it, and it was called the Leo 1, and there were several versions of Leo. That's Leo 1 there, so it fills a room, right? Kind of thing. Ernest Kay is the last surviving member of the Leo 1 team. I knew him as well. He's been a very good friend of mine. And he just died a couple of months ago. The last surviving member of the Leontine. So the links to these periods are not very long ago.
Do you know if any of the Leo stuff was built in Colliers Wood? There was a lion's building in Colliers Wood.
I believe some of the development was done in Colliers Wood, but it was, again, mainly the Manchester people who designed Leo. And, I really don't know where they were actually constructed. I must say, it's a question.
Flowers are looking over your shoulder saying, yeah. I wouldn't do it like that.
Yeah.
Now the information is out. Do you understand where you were getting?
Yes, to some extent. He was very much involved in, well, difficult to say. He knew about race conditions in electronic circuits. Of course, he's working with valves, so the race conditions, the clock times are much slower, right? But he still knew that there were race conditions, and there were certain design rules he had to apply if he was going to run circuits that talk to each other. And I think what he was trying to tell us was that we were violating design rules, right, that he thought should apply. But it's hard to tell. We did have a lot of trouble with making these interprocessor communication channels work. It was always a problem, and it was always due to race conditions. So I think that's what Tommy was talking about. I want to talk about self-defeating technology. This is something you won't find in the history books. This thing here is the Blundell vector slide rule. That's the Blundell vector slide rule. These curves hyperbolic cosines. Okay, so as soon as I tell you that, you will immediately know what function this computer is. I should point out that this was built for the General Electric Company Limited of England. Okay, and it's beautifully constructed, and there could only have been about half a dozen of them made. The function that this was built to compute is the Z transfer. Z transform, I should say. The Z transform function is used when you want to build electronic circuits which have balanced transmission lines. Okay. Never mind. It's pretty overly set, right? The only reason you need that is if you're building very high speed electronic circuits, which are very small, or very low speed electronic circuits, which are very large. And the low-speed ones, which are large, are called telegraph lines, and the problem of designing telegraphs was solved by Heaviside back in the 18th century, 19th century, using balanced transmission lines, which is the transform function which is used to do balancing. When people started to build integrated circuits, they realized that they also needed to have balanced transmission lines, but very tiny ones, and running very fast. So they needed to use the same mathematics, which is why they developed this thing. And the people who were using it was a very small group of electronic circuit designers. But of course, as soon as they designed these electronic circuits, they were used to power calculators that were used to run the Z-transform function, so they didn't need it anymore. Right? So this piece of technology exists in a very, very narrow historical window, right? Where essentially wrote its own death warrant. Another piece of technology like that is the connection between VLSI and the Swiss watch industry, which not a lot of people know about. In order to build VLSI, very large scale integrated circuits, you know how you do it. You photograph layers of the chip, and you print the photograph onto the surface of a wafer, and then you cut the wafer up into dies and stuff like that. You etch it and all that kind of stuff. To do that on a very, very small scale of the wafer and the die, you have to step the plate, the photographic plate, over the surface very, very accurate. And for that you need stepper motors. Very, very accurate stepper motor through. And very, very accurate positioning. Who were the people at the time who built the world's best stepper motors? It was the Swiss watch industry. So everybody in Silicon Valley was going to Switzerland to buy the stepper motors, which to a large extent they still do, until actually last year, when the last of the Swiss stepper motor companies was bought by the Japanese. Never mind. But of course, as soon as they started building these chips, what did they use them for?
Watches.
Just about killed the Swiss merchant machine. Wonderful. Okay, back to computers. Computers and business. Here is the Elliott 153, one of the first computers to be used for business. Elliott's important. Elliott Automation, company in Boreham Wood, just down the road from here. The hub of industry, Boreham Wood. Lots of people who, very important people, work for Elliott, and they're doing relatively menial jobs. Tony Hoare, who's Professor of Computation at Oxford, wrote a compiler, a very early compiler, an Alpha compiler for Elliott, actually. And several other people worked there. It was really the birth of the British computer science profession, was in Elliott. Around about that time, 1958, 4 years later, here's a quote from Jocelyn Simon, Financial Secretary of Treasury, and this is in Hansard, you can go and look it up. He was asked a question, and the Parliament said, at present, he was asked a question about what the government was going to do about buying computers. And he said, at present, four government officers have been equipped with computers, and orders have been placed for equipment for a further four. Studies of the possible use of computers in five more offices have almost been completed. Right? This is only what? 54 years ago. Kind of scary. Programming languages. Start talking about this. This, by the way, is Tom Kilburn. The first program that was run on the Baby, which was the predecessor of the Manchester Mark I and the Ferranti Mark I, developed by Turing, amongst others. So this is a highest common factor routine. So this is the assembler code. It's kind of hard to see. This is the binary. Okay. Has anybody ever written in binary or assembler? Hey! This is a really sophisticated audience, or rather very old. So we used to all write in ones and zeros. When I was working on message switching back in the 60s, we had five-fold paper tape, same as they've got up the road. Murray code. And the messages used to come in a five-fold tape, we'd read them in on a reader. And in order to test the software, you had to get core dumps, essentially, and look at the messages in memory, on drum, as it was at the time. But our hardware, our readers, were such that the bits came in reversed and complemented. So the most significant bit was in the wrong end, and ones were, the holes were zeros and blanks were ones. And I got very expert at reading reverse complemented micro. This is a skill that I preserve to this day. Practice it. More about programming languages. That was Tom Kilburn and stuff. Very early on, people started to construct high-level languages. Grace Murray Hopper, of course. COBOL. Dijkstra points out that the use of COBOL cripples the language teaching. Should be that garbage as a COBOL event. Any COBOL programmers in there? Oh no! Grace Murray Hopper's objective was that business programming should be done in English, or rather in American, of course. You know? So you should be able to write programs that were essentially English language statements about what the business was required to do, and that this would compile into executable code. This had a problem. This is a valid COBOL statement. Divide cake into three. Is anybody able to tell me what the semantics of that is? In a COBOL program.
It's a division of cake by three.
Wrong.
it's not true.
It's a division of three by cake.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
It's a long time ago. The value of the variable 3 divided by the value of the variable k, which is...
You can make it longer and say that you put the remainder in another variable. You could in one statement. Do that and see. You can do a div and a mod in one statement in COBOL.
I agree, but it's still not very perspicacious.
No. Kind of verbose.
Okay, along came later John Backus, Peter Nahr. And then they gave us the BNF, the Backus-Nahr, or Backus-Normal form. The first modern meta-language for formally defining syntax, grammar of languages, and they defined Algol 60 as the first language which had formal definition at all. It's interestingly though, the first formal grammar of a language at all was constructed in about 550 BC by Panini, who gave a formal grammar of Sanskrit in a wonderful document which I've never read called the Ashtadhyayi. Anybody read Sanskrit? No? Okay. but it's interesting that way back in 550 BC, he was actually thinking about, the people were thinking about language from a formal perspective. And it wasn't until much, much later that even though we were building computers, which are essentially formal systems, that we thought of formally defining the languages that we execute, which is kind of silly, really. And we still don't. I mean, is there a formal semantics of Java yet? Really? No? And certainly not of any of the other languages that have come along. As for operating systems, well, there was an attempt to provide a formal model of Unix about 30 years ago, which was never completed, and nobody's ever tried anything else. We don't mathematize our systems at all. More programming languages. Here we are, here's BASIC. Kevin and Cooks, BASIC. Dartmouth College, Dijkstra has something to say about BASIC as well, of course. It's practically impossible to teach good programming style to students that require exposure to BASIC. As potential programmers, they are mentally mutilated beyond hope. How many BASIC programmers are we? Oh, life goes on. More programming languages. Well, Christopher Strachey, very important person. Another programmer for Elliot and for Ferranti. Skian of the Bloomsbury is actually related to Lytton Strachey, the Victorians. He came from an extremely blue stocking type family. He created a language called CPL, which is, everybody thought was Christopher's programming language. It actually stands for something else, which I think was a common programming language, I think. That was developed into a language called BCPL, which is used for simulation, which was taken up by some people at Bell Labs and became B, which was then taken up by some more people at Bell Labs and became C, and of course C gave us Unix. And so Christopher Strachey could be thought of as the ultimate access to the Unix that we all love and know. He became the first professor of computer science at Oxford. He founded the Denotational Semantics. Anybody worked at any computer science graduates who've done Denotational Semantics? No? Scott and Strachey, the standard book, Dana Scott, Christopher Strachey, Denotational Semantics. That tells you what your programs really do, mathematically. Your programs are nothing but manipulations of symbols. Completely abstract things. They don't mean anything other than the mathematical function that they represent. People forget that all the time. And if you really want to know what your program does, the only way to find out, really, you can't test it. You waste time testing. You find out what it doesn't do. The only way to find out what it does is to take its formal semantics and transform that into a predicate transformer. It'll tell you if you give it this, a variable satisfying this predicate, it will deliver a result satisfying that one. And you need denotational semantics and language to do that. But people have forgotten that. Another great man in the history was John McCarthy, of course, who developed Lisp in 1958.
Bracket.
Wonderful book. Anybody ever read this book? The Little Lisp Book. One of the great books of computing. Absolutely superb. Recommend it to you. You can find it, that's second edition. You can find a copy of superb. Tell you everything you want to know about programming. So what was Lisp? A Turing complete language with a few simple operators and a notation for functions. That's all it is. But it provided the foundation for artificial intelligence. Without Lisp, we would have no AI.
Yeah. But it's supposed to know the wrong interviews with McCarthy that he actually discovered lambda calculus after he invented the language. He didn't know about it.
He didn't know about
lambda calculus.
This is absolutely true. This is absolutely true. I should mention that. You're right.
So, yeah. Although it is a language, it's by accident. It's not by design.
He had the same. It's quite interesting. Though, why would he have come up with something like that? I mean, the same concept about functions in the abstract were going around. Then he wasn't a mathematician, actually.
Absolutely.
So you're absolutely right, though.
So were there any machines that can execute?
Yes, there was a chip. There was a chip built by Symbolics, which I'll come to later, which actually ran Lisp
in 1958.
No. No, it was originally it was interpreted. There were list interpreters, but it was later compiled. Then there are lots and lots of list compilers available now, because from the common list is widely used.
There is a major software as a part of the list.
Yes.
So if you read the history of AutoCAD, and then find the design of it, actually what the list to be at the heart of it, which is to this day the case.
And of course, since then, we've had lots of other functional programming languages like ML and Haskell and all these other things, which are essentially derived from the pure functional language. So, McCarthy and Strachey, very important. The point is that these are essentially formalists. These were essentially mathematicians who were using their mathematical intuition and insight, if you like, and bringing it to programming, not the other way around. It is kind of funny. If we go further along that line, we meet one of my great heroes, Robin Milner, who just died a couple of years ago. Lovely man. Also worked in Ferranti as a programmer. He was prof in Cambridge, in Edinburgh, in Stanford. And he invented, more or less, automatic theorem proving. He was the father of ML, of CCS, calculus, of computer systems, computer systems rather. The language for communicating functions and Pi calculus. All of that stuff comes from Robin Milner. There are lots of things you can say about him. One of his among his students were Albert Kohn and George Milne, who were very instrumental in the early days of verification of VLSI. The idea was to take the ideas of semantics that come from programming languages and apply them to electronics, and actually do verification at the digital level of electronics, not at the level of circuit theory and field theory. And this is going to be very important, because as these chips are getting bigger and bigger, especially the security people and the safety people wanted verified systems. They wanted to be able to prove this system was safe and live and wouldn't fall out of the air or blow up or whatever else. And the biggest project that was done using it was actually using Mike Gordon's power of the logic rather than CCS. Was the verification of a chip called the Viper chip. Did anybody come across Viper? You've come across Viper. Viper was a chip that was commissioned by the Australian National Railways to drive the signalling system on the Nullarbor railway line, the 1,200 mile single track railway that runs from Perth to Adelaide, with crossing places. 1,200 miles single track. And they wanted a signalling system that would replace the old system where you had to pull the train and ring up the next station and say, is there anybody on the track? And if not, they want to move up faster. And the signalling system had to be verified, and they needed a piece of verified hardware for it as well. So they commissioned the Viper chip. It was developed. The proof of Viper was done by Avra Cohen, and she wrote a paper on it that said, you know, it was really remarkable, we very nearly verified Viper. And the client went spare, and they sued, and they said, what do you mean very nearly, we paid for it? It was all settled in the end. I mean, it was the most correct chip that's ever been built, but nevertheless, it was not completely verified. It could not be completely verified for all sorts of other reasons. But it was just fun at the time, the way that this reaction of the client said, oh my God. There you go. That's right, and what I want to do is introduce a little bit of theory here, okay, so you actually get some flavour of what computation is and what the foundations of it are. And there's a couple of little games here. The first game is the mutilated chessboard. Has anybody seen this before? Anybody seen the mutilated chessboard? Gosh, I found it. Oh, good. Okay, problem. Here's a chessboard, 8x8, and here is a domino, if you like, which is exactly 2 squares wide. And what I've done is I've taken the 2 corner squares out of the chessboard, and I want to know, so it's now got 62 squares in it, and I want to know if I can cover that chessboard with 31 dominoes without them overlapping. Can I or can't I? Right, I'll ask another question. How would you go about finding out whether or not you could?
Brute force.
Try all the possibilities, yeah? You want to start now? When do you think you're finished?
The domino you've got isn't the 2 squares you're taking out.
No, it's just two squares wide. It's just a two square wide domino. So when you put it on top of the chessboard, it will cover two squares. Okay. So can I? All right, I'm going to tell you, it can't be done. All right, how do I know it can't be done?
Brute force.
I can move them up the side and things. You're missing
two white squares, but that's a white and a black square.
Excellent. Every time I put a domino on a chessboard, I will cover exactly one black square and exactly one white square. Right? This chessboard, however, has two more black squares than white squares. The two squares that have been removed are both white. Therefore, it's impossible. Okay? Simple. This is an issue in invariance. Right? There's an invariant associated with this problem, the invariant being that every time I place the domino on the chessboard, I cover exactly one black and exactly one white square. Use that invariant, apply it over and over and over again, recursively if you like, and I'm able to show that the solution to this problem is impossible. Invariance is an enormously powerful tool in computing, right? It's what we do all the time. Every time you have a loop, you have an invariant. Dijkstra's ball game, here's another little problem. This is from Edsger. It's from Tom Lambert, his students, but it's called Dijkstra's game. Okay, I have a jar, and the jar's got black and white balls in it. Okay? Imagine it's an opaque jar, I can't see inside. I have a pile of black balls in stock. I'll tell you why I need them later. Okay. I have three rules. The way that this is a game, it's a solitaire game. I play it as follows. I take the lid off the jar, put my hand into the jar without looking, and I take out two balls. And I look at the two balls. If the two balls are the same colour, I put a black ball into the jar, discard the two balls. Clearly, if I take out two white balls, I need a stock of black balls in order to get a black ball to put back in the jar. If the two balls are different colours, I put the white ball back and throw the black one away. Right? I continue playing this game until I stop. When do I stop? When does the game stop?
You have to have a white ball.
No. I'm still going to be able to take two balls out.
Never.
It would never stop if I had an infinite number of balls. Yeah?
When you've run out of black balls?
No, because I can still take two balls out.
When
I've got one ball left. Thank you. That's right. When there's exactly one ball left in the jar, because each time I take a one ball out of the jar, I take two balls out and put one ball back. When I get one ball left in the jar, I can't play anymore. The rules don't tell me what to do, so I stop. Okay? Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the jar, I'm going to empty it out on the table. I'm not going to play the game, but I'm going to examine the collection of black and white balls that I've got, and I want to predict what colour the last ball would be if I played the game with those balls. Okay? How are we going to do that?
It's random.
No, it's not. That's pretty wrong. There is a definitive answer. Okay, I'll have to tell you. It's invariant again. All right. If I take out the two balls I take out are the same colour, I put a black ball back. If they're different colours, I put a white ball back. What does this tell you? It says the number of black balls in the jar. The number of white balls in the jar, if it was even to start with, will be even after one move. Because I either take out two balls and don't put a white ball back, or I take out a white ball and put a white ball back. So each move, if the number of white balls was even before the move, it will be even after the move. Invariant. The parity of white balls is invariant. Okay? So if I start off with an even number of white balls, what will the colour of the last ball be? Black.
Because you can never have one white ball.
If I start off with an odd number of white balls, what colour will the last ball be?
White.
Not random. Parity check. White ball parity check. Very simple, absolutely trivial, once you've got the invariant in your head. Right? Easy. That was invariance. Now about recursion and induction. I'm going to prove to you that one and one is two. Right? We'll do it using algebra. So you never think you're going to get this.
I think if we go back.
This is a mess. Here's an algebraic theory. The theory that you can think of this as a class, if you like. It's the Java class. Well, I've got one variable z, which I say is of this type, nat. I've got a unary function s that takes a nat and gives me a nat back. I've got a binary function p that takes two nats and gives me a nat. Okay. And there's some axioms for this. It says, the first axiom says, p of the two digit z, that particular one, and this is a constant, by the way, and some arbitrary number, some arbitrary nat n is always n, and p of s of m and n is the s of p of m and n. What's all that about? Well, z is zero. All right? I'm going to define. Zero, the number zero, let's call it z. The number one will be s of z. S applied to z gives me the number one. S being successor. All right? So s of z is what we call 2. And the plus operator that we always love is going to be this thing called p that takes two natural numbers and does a nat. So we said, if we add 0 to any number, we get the number we started with. If we add the successor of a number to a number, successor of n to n, we get the successor of adding n to n. That defines 0, and it defines all the natural numbers, and it defines addition. Right? In 5 lines. It just defined arithmetic. Right? Well, some of arithmetic. Now I'm going to prove that 1 and 1 is 2. What's that? Here's 1 plus 1. What we normally think of as 1 plus 1. That what that is the plus of the successor of z and the successor of z. Yeah? So I now apply my rules. Axiom 2 I have to use because the first one here is a successor. So p of s of z and s of z is s of p of z. And then the next one is a 0. So I apply axiom 1 and I get s of z of z and I equals 2. This is totally symbolic. It's not even mathematics. This is just syntax. Okay? This is replacement of symbols. That's all I'm doing, just manipulating symbols. Right? Hardly mathematics. But this is what computers do all the time. That's all they do. Right? We think they're actually manipulating things in the world with the variables and the pictures and all the pixels. We think they're actually doing something to the world. They're not. They're just bloody manipulating symbols. Like this. Only a bit more sophisticated. And once we can figure out the rules for the symbol manipulation that's going on, we should be able to tell what all our computers are doing all the time. Mm-hmm. Although we don't bother. Shame. How am I doing?
10 minutes.
10 minutes, okay. I'm going to skip through some history, hardware history. Okay. Minis and mainframes. DEC PDP-8 arrived in 1965. The IBM 360 arrived in 1964. Two ends of the spectrum. The business world used these things, and the telecoms world used these things. Well, the embedded computing world used these things. You notice that the PDP-8 and the IBM 360, if you look carefully enough, still had buttons, the keys and lamps on the front. You were still expected to go up to these things and actually put in the ones and zeros to boot the thing off, you know. Even in the 60s. Much later, remote patch terminals. We're all talking about where the applications run, you know, are they in the client or in the server or whatever. These questions were around then as well. The remote batch terminal was just a dumb terminal that was connecting a communication line to a big computer somewhere. Right? That's all the software around the big computer. And the office just had one of these things. This is the video, remote batch terminal. People got very annoyed with these things way back then. There was a lovely story of an IBM sales engineer who was called out to somewhere, a hick town in the Midwest of the United States, by a customer who said that their remote batch terminal had failed. The sales engineer went way out there. He arrived at the address, discovered it was the sheriff's office. And he walked in, the sheriff's standing there. I said, I hear your tunnels filled. Sure. I said, sure. So where is it? He said, it's in the back room. So he opened up the back room, and there was this tunnel sitting on the desk, two bullet holes in it. What happened? He said, the smart aleck machine told me I was doing something wrong, so I shut it. We don't do that kind of thing anymore. It's sad, isn't it? Single chip micros arrived in 1970. Intel 4004. First ever single chip micro. Actually commissioned by a Japanese calculator company, not by a computer company. It was supposed to run calculators, that's what it was for. That's it. Got that big. That's bigger than life. Cost $200 the chip. 2,300 transistors, 4 kilobytes, 740 kilohertz clock speed. Right? $200 for the chip. How much do we pay now for the hour, is it? Or whatever? It's a bucket of time, isn't it? okay, 1 year later, just 1 year later, 8008, Intel reckoned, hey, good stuff, this, we can build a bigger one. $120, 800 kilohertz, 3,500 transistors, 16K bytes. Okay? 8008 is already being used, was already being used then for personal computers. Alright? The first one that was on the market was the Altair 8800. Did anybody ever have an Altair? If anybody's got one, could I have it? Because I think there's one next door, I'm not sure. Sold as a kit for $400. 10,000 kits were shipped without software. A little company called Microsoft, who was founded in order to supply a basic interpreter for it. They added CPM as the operating system afterwards. That was not Microsoft. Somebody else's. Microsoft stole CPM. Before the Altair, there were several things that came out as single board computers using 8008. One of them I remember was used in my lab in STL. Our president, Harold Janine, who was the guy who founded ITT, since he ran ITT, one of these huge executive guys, right? And he learned that we were building computer systems, and we were thinking of getting into the computer business, and he said, oh, we're a telecoms company, I really want to know more about these computers, can I have one, please? So they... Friends of mine and I put an 8008 and a little bit of RAM in a box, with a beautiful walnut box with a smoke glass lid on it, and some switches sent off to him. And a guy went out there and showed him how to program it, switches and lamps. I thought that's the last we get of that. 2 weeks later, he called up and said, "How do you get more memory on this thing?" So it was very popular at the time. 77, we got the Sol 20. People have forgotten about the Sol 20. It was really nicely presented. That was the first thing that was actually packaged as a device for the house. Neil Felsenstein built that. And he was also the guy who initiated the Kansas City Data Transfer Standard. Standards in those days were few and far between. People were building these machines, but they were all little individual things. And Felsenstein was the first one to say, hey, we need to have a way of being able to send information from one of these to another, right? Even if some paper tape, so that we can read each other's information. And that was the Kansas City standard developed by him. Here's 1977, the Trinity, Apple II, the PET, and the TRS-80. I've got a PET, I haven't got the other two. Again, any confirmation paper, you see. Now, Xerox part. I just want to mention Xerox part. In 1959, Xerox introduced xerographic copying, revolutionary technology to replace the JSTEC spirit copier and things like that. In the first year of operation, that generated so much profit, about two orders of magnitude more profit than the marketing department had predicted. Weird. They didn't sell them, they leased them. And you leased a copier based on the number of copies that you made. So there was two orders of magnitude more copies being made than marketing had predicted. We couldn't understand it. So then some people had to find out, and they discovered that something like 80% of all the copies that were being made were advertising office barbecues. These things were being used for completely trivial purposes, which is why they were so successful. There's a lesson here. They had so much profit from geographic printing, and they had a monopoly in the market for many years, they founded a lab to soak up the excess profits so they wouldn't have to pay tax on it. Yeah. The lab was called Palo Alto Research Center, and they had strict instructions at that lab not to make products. If they made product, they'd pay tax. Okay. Please do not make product. So what did they do? Ethernet, GUI, mouse, you know, small talk, all came out of the park. Right? Sorry about that. Xerox said, I suppose we better try and build some of these things. So they built the Alto in 1973, the very first personal computer with a mouse, graphic user interface, and Ethernet. Steve Jobs saw that in Palo Alto. He said, I must have one of those. And that's what led him to the design of the Mac. If Jobs hadn't seen that, he wouldn't have built the Mac. They didn't continue with this. It was a very unsuccessful product. Very expensive, of course. They went on to design the Dandelion and Xerox Star. I had two of them in my lab in the 80s. It was great. That had a Symbolics chip. That ran on a Symbolics chip, this chip. It cost $16,595. Yes, that's a new colour workstation. but Xerox rejected it as a product line. They said, we're not going to go in that business. And they essentially left the computer business. So, there you go. But personal computers came on after that. The Atari 400, the original games machine. This is one of the most successful computers of all time. People forget about that. They sold 4 million of them in the 80s. 4 million Ataris were sold, which is hard to believe. IBM thought of buying the Atari, thought of buying the company, but instead they developed a PC. Now I ask you, was that a sensible decision? The operating system was MS-DOS, which is stolen by Microsoft from CPM, based on QDOS, which is based on CPM. And IBM was foolish enough to give Microsoft the rights to the software, the full rights to the software. They kept the rights to the hardware. Again, stupid decision. Home computers, you know all about them. And you know all about that as well. I need to tell you guys about that stuff. Meanwhile, telecoms, okay? Alexander Graham Bell, professor of elocution, developed a telephone in 1847. Oh, sorry, he was born in 1847. In the 1870s, he developed a telephone. In 1876, the president of Western Electric declined to buy the patent for $100,000. Bell offered them the patent of telephony. He declined it. And 2 years later, they thought telephony was just a toy. 2 years later, he offered $2 million for the patent, and he was refused because the Bell system was in existence. I ask you though, who bought the first telephone? Who in his right mind bought the first? Nobody had talked to. So just because products don't seem valid, there's no reason not to build them. It's another lesson. Right. Another very important man, Astrager. Who's had Astrager? Anybody have Astrager? Hey, some telecoms people in the audience. Astrager was an undertaker. Okay. In LaPorte, Indiana. Tiny little town in Indiana.
I'm sorry,
I've got to
stop you.
I'll tell people the story of Astrager later. Thank you.
No, really sorry to be the bad guy.
How do you stop this?
I should mention.